In the South Korean capital of Seoul, we've made contact with a young man of 26 years who, until 2 years ago, didn't know that a world existed outside of the barbed wire.
I didn't know, not at all, not until I escaped.
He quite simply thought the whole world was a prison camp. He didn't know that the country, North Korea, existed, that something exists outside of that country. He didn't even know that the mastermind behind his miserable life was Kim Jong-il. The children from Camp 14 were so worthless that they didn't deserve knowledge of the life and thoughts of the dear leader. Shin Dong-hyuk is not special in the sense that he has escaped the North Korean prison system. Tens, if not hundreds of thousands of prisoners are locked up there, and a few have managed to escape. But he's unique in the sense that he's the only one known to have escaped a so-called special control zone. That's a special camp system within the camp system, where prisoners are expected to spend their whole life. He's the only one who has come out alive and has been able to tell his story. We meet Shin at an old prison. Here the Japanese kept, tortured and murdered Korean patriots before and during the Second World War. It's an environment that he recognizes immediately.
I was in a cell exactly like that.
Shin Dong-hyuk's story began on the 19th of October, 1982. His parents were prisoners in Camp Number 14, isolated in the mountains north of the North Korean capital of Pyongyang. The reason why is not known, but as a reward for good behavior, they were selected for marriage and put together in a cell for 5 days. 9 months later, Shin was born behind the fence. One thing followed him every day.
We were always hungry.
The little boy was placed with his mother. But she worked every day in the mountains and mines from 5 a.m. When she returned around midnight, she had no time for the boy. She often beat him. He learned nothing about common humanity.
I had no real feelings when I was a kid.
Two categories of people inhabited the world behind the wire.
Those who made mistakes were prisoners, those who made no mistakes were guards.
In the eyes of the little boy, the starved and sometimes beaten woman who returned to him at night was the cause of his suffering.
My mom had made mistakes, so it was only natural that we should live like this. I didn't even want to know why.
At 5 he was sent to school in the mornings. They taught him to read and write, to add and subtract. The teachers were guards with pistols and sticks to beat the little ones. One day he witnessed a teacher beating a little girl on the head so hard that she died the next day. In the afternoon, the 5-year-old was sent to the mountains to do hard labor. The only positive thing about that was that it was possible to catch mice, rats, worms and snakes for the eternally hungry stomachs. Friendship and closeness didn't exist. Everyone was on his own. Everybody else could be an informer.
Our society was constructed in a way so that my mother was supposed to inform on me and I would inform on her.
The day came when Shin was taken from his mother. He was placed in a dormitory and supposed to attend secondary school.
From 12 years on, it was nothing but work. But they called it secondary school. There was no reading or stuff like that.
It would be 2 years before he was to see his mother and an unknown brother again. But before that, he was suddenly dragged out from the dormitory by guards, thrown into an isolation cell, and subjected to unspeakable torture. His mother and brother had attempted to escape, The idea was to get the 14-year-old boy to reveal if he knew anything about the attempt, but he knew nothing and couldn't tell anything. The torture went on for 7 months. One day, it was the 29th of October 1996, Shin was dragged out to an open square and placed in the first row of the prisoners there. He thought he was about to be executed, but then they brought out his mother and his brother.
I think it is better we skip this part.
The brother was shot. The mother hung. She was tied up and gagged, but just before she died, she looked directly at him. He avoided her eyes. From then on, a miserable life was transformed to daily naked horror.
After the death of my mother, I had an incredible hard time. I was beaten every day. I almost died.
The other children attacked him. "Your life is lost," they yelled and laughed. They stole his food, and all the time he hated his mother and brother for what they had done.
I blame them a lot. It's hard to express. But it was a good thing that they died. After all they had committed, a crime.
Years went by. Shin was teamed up with a guy who had lived outside the wire. He told the boy about Kim Jong-il and his father Kim Il-sung, and about the fact that a world existed out there where there was endless amount of food every day.
The food made me escape. Even if it was going to cost me my life, the only thing that interested me was the food.
One day in January 2005, he was in the mountains with a friend, hauling timber. It was twilight and cold, the guards were away for a moment, the electric fence was only 20 meters away. This was the chance of a lifetime.
If we don't run now, we may never get the chance again.
We shall return to Shin's escape, but before that we have another contact to meet. Shin's friend, Hyuk Kang. Kang has made the drawings for this program based on his own experience and the stories of Shin and other defectors. We meet 23-year-old Kang at a modest private center that collects documentation about North Korean defectors.
Kang, is that you? Are you good to see you?
Shin and Kang are small guys. Their bodies themselves document that something is awfully wrong in the North.
So these are your drawings?
Children in North Korea are much smaller. Sixth graders in South Korea are more than 170 centimeters in height. In North Korea, they are
150 to 160.
Their faces are always swollen because of hunger.
Kang hasn't been to the camps, but he knows hunger very well. It arrived in earnest in his small provincial town during the early 90s, where North Korea was grinding to a standstill. There was no economy, no fuel, no work. Worst of all, the state food coupons became worthless. The shelves were empty. The first to die were the old people and small children. The bigger kids and adults were out in the mountains digging for moles, rats, mice, frogs, and even rainworms. The landscape changed from green to brown.
The mountains were cleared of anything green. Eventually, they didn't look like mountains, just bare soil.
The town sank into deep apathy. Many homeless people settled in the ice-cold railway stations, but trains rarely arrived. The orphans, who were too small, withered away and died.